We are here for advanced deal structure. this course, actually the aim of this course is higher than the steel structure you learn in the undergraduate level, of course, because it is not aimed to teach you how to design, step-by-step design. That was supposed to be instructed in the undergrad level already. So you go through AISC code, and then you make all the, well, go through all design formula, check point by point. That is a standard procedure for steel design. The thing is that this course emphasizes on the behavior of the steel structure, okay, which is the important part for you as a designer. When you follow the code, generally you do not understand what's behind the code. You adopt the formula given in the code. You put the numbers, you put the bending moment, shear force, and then you try to satisfy through the equation given in the code, right? But you can see that most of the equation given in the code, well, if you think about the RC structure, you know that when you learn the cross-section mechanics, MC over I, the shear force, etc., etc., okay. What you learn there when it comes to the material, in the real material, there are more concerns than the cross-section mechanics that you learn. So you never see the normal formula you learn in the strength of material course or mechanics of material course in the design code of RC, and likewise for the steel, because there are more things that you need to concern. For steel, mostly you have the stability problem. The difference between the steel and the RC structure majorly is size of the member. When we talk about the RC, the strength of concrete generally how much? 60? Well, that's quite a high strength already. 30-40 MPa strength, that are generally used for the design and construction. You don't go, well, 60 is like very high-end projects already, high-rise buildings and need to squeeze the size of the core, etc. Generally, normal construction, yeah, about that, 30-40. And when we compare this number with the steel is, but well, for my steel, you have 240, right? 240, 250 MPa. So 40 versus 240, that makes 6 times difference. So if we just think about the design of these two materials, just a quick think, it is not the precise detailed analysis. You just think quickly, then if you need the size of the member to carry maybe just the tension, the easiest thing, tension or compression, okay, you concrete, we don't want it to keep to carry tension, right? So for compression, the same amount, you will need just 1/3, okay, 1/6 for the steel cross section, you know, compared to the concrete cross section. So 6 times smaller. So generally, as the strength for steel is higher, we go for the small area. Steel structure generally lighter, but you have pro, and you're gonna have the consequence of that pro. As you need less material, smaller cross-sectional area, you have the stability problem. And stability problem occur not only in like the overall member aspect. Overall member aspect is like the whole column buckling. the beam lateral torsional buckling, that's the whole overall big picture aspect. So not in that aspect only. It also come into the cross-sectional aspect. So you have the stability of the flange problem, also stability of the web, so you can have web buckling, flange buckling, twisting, etc., etc., because it is very flimsy. When you look into steel cross-section, the commercial cross-section available in the market, very flimsy. But if you look into RC cross-section, you have like solid rectangular shape cross-section. So you don't have to worry much about the stability issue. And that's the benefit. You don't worry much into this, but of course the weight of the structure is higher. And what else? Self weight of the material of the member, okay, is higher. That seems to be the burden for the member itself. Okay, so the formula we see in the design code, so many crazy formula you learned in the undergrad, you go through the design handbook and then you see like a square root of E times G times J times whatever, and then you look at that and what are these and who put together the E, C, J, okay, etc. in that square root? How does this come from? Well, we will look into that in this course. So the design formula used for the steel structure, we will come down to the derivations, right? And then you have the better feel about these given formulas, sets of formulas, and then you use it like, oh, I use this formula because of this, right? You must have learned that in column there might be elastic buckling, inelastic buckling, etc., etc. Then we will look into all these failure modes. There are many literatures, studies, and you know, the studies for steel structure has long been done, so more than 50 years. So we're gonna look into many literatures, very old. That's the fundamentals for steel structure analysis and design. The thing is that please come in. So the behavior of the steel structures, told you it has many modes of failure. So you have either the inelastic behavior for the steel itself, and then you have the nonlinearity that is coming from the geometry of the structure. So from the combination of these nonlinearities, material nonlinearities and geometrical nonlinearities, all these combine and make some sort of unique behavior in steel structure, something that you will never see in the RC. Okay, you design the column for RC, okay, you don't have so many different failure modes, but in here all the formulas are derived from that aspect. I will come to this page later, that will be talking about the load factor, strain reduction factor a bit. before we get into the further detail, but course syllabus, okay, too bad I didn't update it from 2015, but this year it will be Tuesday and Wednesday 8:30 to 10:00, right? So I may not need to overtime, okay? Life is normal like other classes now, compared with the last semester that you had 2.5 hour for one class, right? Venue in 240, this room. Assignment, well, that depends. If this course, number of registration is so small, then it will be just the sit-in course, and there will not be any formal assignment, and there will not be any examination. Okay, so that depends. I would love that too. So I will not talk about this much, but it is not, well, I think I scare people out at in 2015 for the 8 to 12 homework, because for this course I end up like too lazy to give you the assignment. There will be assignment in finite element, but this course you learn, and then well, exam. So it is an examination based course. Finite element is an assignment based course. So you're gonna find a lot of assignment in finite element, like computer method. But this one, we will put everything in the final examination. Yeah, midterm and final examination. So the outline. Yes, we have an introduction about the steel structure. Member under tension, we move to the column, right? Beam column, we have beam. Actually, we will emphasize on 2 and 4. So the design formula and mode of failure will be discussed. You will look into every governing equation for each failure mode. Stability issue. So stability we learned in computer method. If you remember, I emphasize you one thing. We deal with all elastic buckling. That was just one step buckling. For the real structure, you might end up with inelastic buckling. How do we cope with the situation like that? Okay, we will talk about it here. Well, you know, if you run the decent finite element analysis that incorporate the nonlinearities, well, that's a lot of work, and that is not practical for an engineer. So you cannot make money to pay for your food if you run nonlinear finite element analysis for the column design. So there will be some simplification that is legitimate, okay? That is good and can be used to simplify the analysis and design for the stability issue. Oops. Next, bracing. We might not come down to the 7. Bracing. Generally, when you design for the brace, there are two kinds of the brace. The first brace, it's like you learn wind engineering, you learn earthquake engineering, you design the brace to carry the horizontal force. That is the kind of bracing that you know the magnitude of force. But the bracing we will emphasize here are the bracing system that you do not have force. Why? These are the bracing for the stability. Okay. So this is quite interesting. You do not know the force, then when you are in the market, when you practice, you just put some number. Well, I think the bar with the diameter 20 millimeters might hold for this, because you don't know how much force is going to occur. You have a column, maybe two columns. You have force. You want to brace somewhere to make sure that when it buckle, it is gonna go like this. Let me ask you, what is the force in the brace? You don't know. You cannot compute. You can compute eigen buckling, right? But you don't know the force in the brace, in the base. So there are ways to look at this problem and ways to find the strength and the stiffness of the bracing element such that the main element, the element that is being braced, will carry the load up to the capacity that we wish. So we do not want this system to go like this. That load is much less, at least like four times less than the blue one full sign curve buckling. Okay, so how? Yeah, we will look into this, and it will be quite amazing that the derivations and the development in the past just brought us to something very simple. So you can look into the formula given in AISC. Very simple. It's a sort of rule of thumb figures that you use for the brace design, but yet very efficient. And it is better for you to use something that is logical. When you bring up the design code handbook, well, either ACI 318 or the AISC, and then you just, well, for ACI, if you just look at the left column and you never read the commentary, that's some sort of disaster. Sometimes you might not bump up into the disaster exactly, but you are doing something that you are not so certain about. Read the commentary. For AISC, they separate the commentary and the code at the different places. So they review the code first, and then the commentary come pretty much like the appendix. So look into this when you have time, and when you have doubt, just go ahead, read. They will refer, they will cite the paper that is the source of the code. Every piece of code, they cite it. So if you are not sure if the situation that you are dealing with will fit the formula given in ACI, AIC, read the literature. And many times in the code always allow you to do something better than the code. Because the code is for the practicing engineer. Practicing engineer level means like something very general, you got to do it like a day-by-day things. So it simplifies many things. But in many situations, that is quite challenging. Okay, yes, you are a practicing engineer, and still you might need to get better estimation or information. So commentary tells you how to come up with that better estimation, and where, I mean the citation, okay, which paper that you might read, which knowledge that you might adopt and use. They allow the better options in the code, right? So look at the code as the guideline. Code is not everything, okay? It's a guideline. You can always do something better than the code requirement. And the code says so. It says explicitly that you are allowed unless, okay, you might compute it by this. So that unless, okay, tells you that you can do better. So this class, we're gonna start from the production of steel. Okay, we get some idea how does steel come. Mechanical properties of steel, the taste of steel, failure criteria, okay, and fundamental mechanics of cross section. So this is the big picture of how the steel production looks like. So you must start from the mining. The mining of steel, okay, the first step, you get the raw material. I'll just go quickly through this process because there will be more detail for each step later. You put all material into the blast furnace, right? This process, I'm just not sure about this process. Sometimes it is not listed in the chart. But you move your material and you do some sort of purifying it, further purification, and then you cast, and your end product turns out to be the huge piece, thick piece of steel. So start from the first one. This is a steel mine. I got a chance. Actually, the steel mine in Thailand, we also have in some region like the east part of Thailand, eastern region in Cha Cheng Sao. So I used to stop by, and you see a lot of rocks, gravel, stone like this. But the thing is that as soon as you grab one up, you pick up, generally one piece of rock like this, you can estimate. You have a feeling that it will be about this much, this heavy, because you do a lot of concrete mixing in the lab. You know, okay, it will weigh this much. But once you grab the steel ore from the mine, you will have three times the weight of the normal rock, because the rock, the specific gravity is about 2.4. If it is not crushed, alright, if it is not the bulk. So 2.4, 2.5, 2.6, but once you get the steel, then it turns out to be 7.8. Okay, so that is much heavier. You can see the red color, that is the oxide of the steel. Yeah. So the thing is that we can do the mining like this in Thailand, but the refinery process, the next step, we don't have any facility in Thailand. In many countries around, okay, there might not be. So it is the heavy industry for the steel. So we can process something after the billet, but we cannot do the process around here. The facility like this in Thailand is not available. So after this, for Thailand, we export this to China and let the Chinese purify it. So this is how it looks like. It looks like just a normal rock, but it is much heavier. The production of steel needs the heat. So you need to melt out the iron. Okay, you need the heat, and the source of the heat is coming from the coal. So the process that take out the iron from this raw material, that is the process that leave the carbon footprint, a lot of carbon footprint on Earth. The production of the steel, a big player in the world these days is the Australian. So Australian companies, they look for, they purchase the carbon credits from other countries in the world, because you know the trade of the carbon credit, né? So if there is some sort of factory and that factory use the process that is certified that it help reduce the carbon release, carbon dioxide gas release into the house's atmosphere, then he or she or it or the company, okay, will get the carbon credit. Whereas those who produce carbon dioxide to the atmosphere will be penalized, right? Because they are the source, they are the reason for the greenhouse gas. Carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas. It will be coating our atmosphere, and then it will trap the heat inside the world. So basically, you have the radiation from the sun, it comes in to the Earth's surface, and it reflects back. Carbon dioxide retain the heat, so the heat just reflects back from the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere and reflects back to the Earth's surface. So it traps the heat. That makes the temperatures of the world increase continuously. Also, sea level rising, every environmental problems mostly are contribution from the carbon dioxide. Well, production of concrete is even worse. If we look at the steel structure and we say, oh, this is the problem. Well, we look at the concrete structure, that is the problem, that is even worse. Because the production of concrete steel, you need the high heat, you need to burn the gas, for sure, you release the carbon dioxide, and steel is reusable. So once you finish one building, you put it there for 50 years, you need to recycle it. You tear it down, you bring every single piece of steel and you recycle. So the recycling process doesn't make much carbon dioxide release, unlike the original production process. But for concrete, you cannot recycle. You tear down the building and then that's it. It's just a landfill. So you have zero chance to recycle. And that is the problem for the environment. So, well, steel is more expensive. And that is the reason why generally steel is being used in those developed countries. Japan, America, European country, for the high-rise building, they use steel because the construction labor cost is cheaper. And steel, just a matter of fact, you bolt things together, so the construction speed is really good. Lighter weight, you save the cost for the foundation. For the lighter weight, you have less force for the earthquake, because earthquake is totally about the inertial force. So the less weight, the less force. Okay. So for the production, you need to use coal for steel. But the coal will be treated. It will be passed through the high temperature without oxygen. It is transformed to the next kind of material. We call it coke. Coke is like this. It looks more or less like a sandstone, but it is black, charcoal color, hard. Alright. So the coal is from the coal, of course, you know that it is the collections of the organic materials, plants in millions of years ago, dies in the swamps, and then it gets packed and covered, and it transforms into the coal. So it's organic material. And it is good that these organic materials under the world, covered by the soil, so that is the carbon from million years ago that were trapped under the world. But the human being in the last 100, 200 years tried to dig this up and release it back to the atmosphere. Okay, that's what we do. Oh, and another thing for Australia, they have iron. They also have the coal, because they are a main, okay, one of the main exporter of the coal. Thailand, we import the coal from Australia, and high quality coal like anthracite, they sell it. So they have both, they have steel and they have coal. So that's the perfect place to do the steel business. So we get two things we mix together. First is the iron ore, which is this. Grind it down into the dust, into the powder. Some limestone, okay, to make sort of, to collect the impurities and make the slag and coal. So the blast furnace, this is so called the blast furnace. It is like a chamber, high chamber. You put everything, okay, that was the mixture, okay, from the top. You have the hot air, the heat going on, blowing up. So when everything falls down, the coal will burn, produce the heat. Iron ore will be melted down. The limestone will collect the impurities and cause some sort of slag. Okay, slag is lighter than steel, so slag will be floating at the top. That is the first time we take out the impurities, because from iron ore you have many things. This is a natural material, so it's a mixture of organics, non-organics, some sort of rocks, etc. So you take this out, you get molten iron, you put this in. This will be ready for the next step production. So we have the material over here. They might cast it down into pieces. It will not be in the bloom like the final production. It will be like small little pieces. They bring everything into the next step. So this step is the purifying step. This purifying step, you have the molten iron and molten slag inside here. How to melt it down? The first step, when you melt everything down, you use the blast furnace. You blow the hot air from the bottom. But now, this step, you put those metals from the first step in this chamber. And how do we heat it? We're gonna heat it using some sort of induction technique. This rod is a graphite. If you want to look into this, you can go to Alibaba and then Google Alibaba app, not Google app, Alibaba app for the facility for steel production. You will see many pictures that is from China. Okay. So this is a graphite rod. Graphite like the one you have in the pencil. So the graphite, and then you put the high voltage in. So you're gonna see the spark, high temperatures there, and then you dip this graphite rod inside this material. So for a while, it melts down. This is the most efficient way to melt down the steel. And then it turns out to be the liquid in here. You have the oxygen lens. Oxygen lens, if you blow in the oxygen, generally when you have oxygen blow into active element, you will have the oxidation. Okay, so this is one way to clean out some unwanted element in steel. So you let the oxidation go. Okay, so it blows in and for a while they will move it to the degassing chamber. Okay, so this is just the transportation to the next step, oxygen furnace in Ohio steel mill. Okay, but let's see. You have the pure oxygen, okay, blow in. Charging raw material means the original condition. Composition of hot metal, amount of gas collected, amount of slag produced, 50 kilogram per ton. Composition of molten steel. Let's see. Originally, carbon 4% of mass, reduced down to 0.04%. So it is like 40 ppm, 40 times in a million, reduce a lot. Why do we need to reduce this much carbon? You blow oxygen in, oxygen collects the carbon. The output is the carbon dioxide, right? You hate carbon because carbon is the brittle part. Of course, carbon enhances the strength of steel, but it is the brittle part. So the structural steel, you need the ductile material. You get rid of the carbon. You put some amount that is good enough, just ppm level, not percent level. Okay. Silicon, magnesium, potassium, okay. Sulfur. You can see that other materials are not affected as much as carbon. Okay, just a little bit. And when we talk about the steel production, everything, every impurities they put in to enhance the properties are in that less than a fraction of percent, generally. So that's why in the market these days, people just give you the steel of which the strength is much higher than the nominal strength. So if we look for the 400 MPa grade, you end up with 550 when you test in the lab. The point is that the industrial standard There are many. Well, in Thailand, we use Thai industrial standard. Other countries, European countries or America, they use theirs. Mostly we adopt from them. But sometimes we don't get everything from them. We get just the easy part from them many times. The point is that industrial standards say that the strength must exceed some industrial standard that is very good, say that the band should be around this number to this number. But for now, we just stick to must exceed. So must exceed means, okay, as long as it exceeds this number, it is okay. So the throw in impurities, and as you can see, the impurities is just a part per million. So it doesn't cost much compared to the whole batch. The whole furnace, it is nothing. And if you are stingy with that impurities, amount of impurities, and then end up you don't pass the standard, because you're gonna need to collect the samples, like, in order to be able to say that the whole batch passed or with the level of confidence more than 90 something percent, this batch passed. That means you must this is a distribution, eh? So in order to say that your nominal strength 40 MPa 400 MPa, most just a few percent, right, can fail, and most of these must pass. So out of your population, you are allowed to have the material that fail this requirement for just a few. You cannot do anything 100% in engineering world, right? You cannot say that my steel will never fail the requirement for 400. You cannot say so, because when you collect the samples, you might get number maybe one value here, one value here, one value here. Then you establish, you get the standard deviations, you get the X bar, right? Still, this will suggest that if this steel batch will have this amount that is less than the given number or not. You might not sample and get the point here, but if you have a big standard deviation, then you have chance to bump up with that. So they don't want to bother, they don't want to waste their time to make money, right? They just make it over standard and make sure that the business is okay, right? So they put more impurities. Strength is more than enough, and then the engineer, we use the nominal strength for the design, but the reality you get the higher strength. There are two aspects. This is not always good. One thing, yes, it is good. It yields after our anticipated value. So that's something that could be good. But in contrast, the ductility of structure reduces. For example, if you do the reinforced concrete design, and you can run that moment Microsoft Excel spreadsheet we make during the holiday for the cross-sectional analysis, and the definition of the failure for ACI in flexure say that concrete at 0.003 strain or 3000 micro strain, that is the definition of concrete failure, crushing. regardless of the amount of reinforcement for the hoop confining effect, ACI doesn't count that, because you know that concrete when you put the hoop in, it crush later, right? But ACI say, okay, we shall not call it. It is a good thing to have, but the failure definition is defined at 3,000 microstrand. Whereas in the latest code of ACI 31819, the requirement for the definition of ductile failure or tension control failure is 5,500 microstrand. 5,500 microstrand, that's huge, right? So this will give you the fee factor equals to 0.9. If you used to see the code for ACI, strain reduction factor, I never remember the number, but this is 0.9. Over here is a transition zone. Over here 0.65. All right. So this is the compression control. This is the tension control. Middle is the transition. This axis is a strain, which is the tensile strain in a steel reinforcement. Tensile strain in a steel reinforcement at failure. So at the definition of failure. Here 0.0055. It used to be 0.005. Now 0.0055. That means the definition of tension control is more rigorous than the past. At the failure, your steel has to go all the way to 5500 microstrand. What is the yielding of the steel? Well, when we talk about the microstrand unit, I think I'll cover. We talk about that maybe in the past already. Fy for steel, you have 250, 400 MPa. So you could end up with a 600 MPa grade for steel reinforcement, rebar. A is 200 GPa. So at the yielding, if it is 250 grade, then you have 21250 microstrain, which is equal to 0.00125. The micro strain means you just multiply by 10 to the minus 6, right? If you multiply by 10 to the minus 6, then 1250 micro strain will turn out to be the strain unit of 0.00125. The thing is that you have too many zero in front of there, difficult to call, so we switch to microstrand unit, so 1200 microstrand. You get the idea that, oh, okay, this is where the steel, my steel, start yielding. If you use grade 400, then you end up with 2000 microstrand. That's a yielding. The data acquisition system or the strain gauge system can pick up roughly, generally, about 1 microstrand resolution. So the data logger in the lab can handle 1 in 1,000 or 1 in 2,000 of the, make a small increment in 1,000 of the yield of the steel. If you want to do something which is more precise, in a normal model testing for the capacity, physical model testing in the lab, Generally, you test the structure to the failure. So you expect at least you go above the yielding, right? Then the normal strain gauge and normal data acquisition system is enough. For this purpose, it is slow testing. You don't need the dynamic. But for some application, what I'm playing, for example, I do the small strain measurement from ambient wind, not even the design wind load, from ambient wind or from the tremor of the ground and cause the building to shake just a little bit. The vibration level is about causing like 5 microstrain. Or even in the real bridge, if you attach the strain gauge after the completion of the bridge and let the truck, one truck, not the full scale load testing, put like 20 trucks on the bridge, not like that, just one truck passing by, driving by, you get just 5 microstrain in concrete. Where is the crushing? Crushing is 3000, huh? 0.003. Peak is 2000. A concrete model is like this. This is 2000. This is 3000. So this is what you learn from advanced C. Yeah. So at ambient, it is there 5 microstrain. Very small. So data acquisition system, normal system, normal strain gauge will not be good enough because the resolution to the full range of 5, you have the just only 5 increments. Whereas when you do the physical model testing, you get 1 in 1,000. You have at least 1,000 to 2,000 increments all the way to the yielding. Okay, but here you have only 5. So that will be the different kind of strain gauge system, which is so called semiconductor strain gauge. That will be good enough for nano strain level measurement. So yeah, I play a lot with this. Actually, I'll give you the access to the class for the structural health evaluation and testing of the structure, so you'll be able to educate yourself for the data acquisition system in the structural engineering application, because I talk about strain gauge, displacement transducer, force transducer, accelerometers, many kinds of sensors, or not many, all kinds of sensors we use in structural engineering purpose. So that I also include something about the semiconductor strain gauge. If you have to run the lab testing in your thesis, at least put it, listen to this before you go to bed. And yeah, if the worst case is like you fail asleep, right? So that's it. It might be like very boring or very sleepy, but okay, the worst case, you just okay learn something before you lose conscious in the bed. Yeah, that's the last thing in the day. It's not the mandatory course. I'll be thinking of opening it. But yeah, I have the video tape recorded for the professional master program, so that's the whole course talking about load testing, equipment, vibration testing, so on and so forth. Okay, but we come back. Okay, we come back here. So 0.0055 is 5500. Yield is there. That means, but this is quite the grade that is not available these days. The round bar grade to have the 250 MPa. generally you will have at least 2,000. At least 2,000, and if your strength is over the nominal strength, like 5, you expect 400, you get 550, then you get the 2650. For the, is that 2,6? 2,250? 2,7? So basically SEI just require you to yield a little bit before you call yourself a ductile cross section. So yielding is here, then you are above the yielding. You have some inelastic deformation in steel sufficiently before you say that it is ductile. So what happens if your strength is higher, then you might not be able to make it yield, because nominal strength is 400. You put the steel that is compared from Fy being 400, but in reality when you put the real steel in your section, you put the 550 in, so you have 150 extra. That makes your strain from 0.005. If you design and put the amount of steel such that it is right there at 0.0055, then this number will drop down to something less than 0.0055. And then you are not eligible to use this fee reduction factor being 0.9. So if you want to comply with the code even after the construction, well, many times the engineer just say that, well, it's not my business because I'm not the contractor, I don't care. 40 being used or 550 being used, it's not me, I didn't do it. Okay, so if you want to go ahead with that logic, it's okay legally, right, in the legal aspect, because you follow this code say that it's like this, and then you use the nominal strength being this number, fine, you are good enough. But if you really want to avoid, if it is an important element that you really need the ductility, then you need to put less steel, making sure that you get the capacity with that less steel. Generally less steel, less capacity, so it might make your cross section a little bigger. You put less steel, then your strain over here, it could be 0.0065 when you do the cross-sectional analysis. Concrete crush at the same definition, of course, steel yields to this number, and then you can balance the compression and tension inside the cross-section. You compute the moment accordingly that way. And then when it comes to the construction side, higher strength being used. So higher strength being used, then strength drop. And then you get maybe less, you end up with 0.0055. Okay, that's beautiful. But well, when you come to the market, many times you will not follow ACI much, because your cross section might be a little bigger than others. If you want to follow everything, and if you want, it is good for your house design. You have a good feeling, or for some design of the very important structural elements, yes, it is good. But in a normal market for house design, then your client may complain if you make the good ductility member like this. size is bigger, you put less steel, but the concrete, remember, the cross section is bigger, more load, heavier, the price. Okay. So this is the one problem that just to satisfy the industrial standard, just to make the strength higher, just to be frustration free, making sure that production line will not be interrupted by the quality control point of view, that is harmful to the engineering structure in some situations. For steel structure, if you want, especially under the earthquake design, you want the structure to dissipate the energy under the shaking ground motion. Okay, you expect a yielding in the reversal kind of yielding. Okay, you sway back and forth. But if your structure is too strong, so you might not get the yielding, but you get other mode instead of yielding. It does not yield, but it comes to the elastic buckling. That is unfavorable. The yielding of the cross section that leads to the plastic moment, plastic hinge formation, that is very favorable for the earthquake engineer, because that's the place where the energy is dissipated. But if it does not yield, but it go to the geometric nonlinearity instead of yielding, then you'll be in trouble. Yielding will reduce the force in the next place, right? But if it does not yield, then the force, the stress, will be maintained high, and then you might end up with the different mode of failure from what you designed initially. After that oxygen injection process, so you come down to the degassing process. Degassing process is you vacuum the molten iron and molten steel. So inside the liquid, there might be the air bubble trapped. So you vacuum, make sure that all gases are coming out before you do the continuous casting. So you pour, you can see here the red hot steel, you pour, and then the caster just make the product out into forms, slab and bloom. This is an asset. Somebody purchase gold and collect it look at the market, and then you buy it when it's cheap, you sell it out when it is expensive. Steel is also another thing that you can actually, I think if you look into the financial market, you can if you want to invest and try to make profit, but I will say that this market is very difficult, especially if the steel, those who sell steel products, they get hurt from the swinging steel price a lot already. So they also say that this is very difficult market. But one of the player in Thailand called Sahaviriya, not doing that well in the stock market these days. But anyway, they have like a million tons of bloom and slabs stored in the southern part of Thailand. Sahaviriya is I'm not sure if it is the biggest one in Thailand or not, but it is very big. Many years, 30, 40 years ago, they surveyed the whole course of Thailand, and they found that the part that can handle the deepest waste still, because the steel business, you need to transport the material and the product from the ship. And the ship for steel transportation will need the depth of the water, and the Bay of Thailand, Gulf of Thailand, it is quite just a shallow water, so roughly about 30 meters for the depth. So they found the place that can handle the deepest part of the Gulf of Thailand, and then they purchased the facility, the land quite big, okay, in that southern part of Thailand, make the port for that kind of ship, and they store like million tons of this bloom and slab there. They are not worried if someone will just come and grab it, because each piece of this like weigh like 10 tons or more than 10 tons. You look at the bloom, the size of the bloom is about this cross section, and then 6 or 9 meters in length. So it's not possible to carry by just a normal machinery. Don't even worry about the in Thailand we call saleng, those who get the scrap or something valuable in the trash, like a piece of iron, plastic bottles, collect and sell for the recycling. With the gas cutter, you imagine the big piece like this, it's gonna take you forever to use the gas cutter to go through. So the saleng will not be coming and bother this storage. And they are not worried about corrosion, because normally after this production into the bloom or slab, steel will be coated with the oxide, the gray surface, okay. So that makes the corrosion process quite, it slow down the process. And the exposure area compared to the cross-sectional area, the ratio is very low, because it is a thick cross-section. Unlike the wide flange, you have a lot of exposure, right, the area, but this is the solid piece, so exposure is very small compared to the cross-section. Even for the slab, you will need a very special machinery, okay. It is like the equipment that is produced and is dedicated for the slab transportation. I used to go down to that facility and see a lot of equipment and machinery for the steel industry. So the production of steel, we get, this is the steel, the commercial cross section, not the production from the very beginning. This is where you have the bloom and slab. So people keep it in this form before making it out to the commercial cross section, and the reason is for this, you can just keep it and wait for the price and wait for the demand, okay. And you have no idea how much how much wide flange this size will be needed in the market, okay. So they store the bloom and slab and wait for the time, and then they reheat. So this reheating is not going to bring your steel all the way to the melting. It is just reheating to the point where it is malleable. Malleable means you can do something with it, okay. Deformable, okay. Malleable. So you start with rough milling. Rough milling, okay, from the from the shape like this, we'll get into something looks like the pie cross section, I pie cross section, and then you go further, okay, and further to the finishing, okay, and then you cut it to the length you want, put it in the cooling bed. From here to here, there'll be a lot of stress, because but still it is heated, it is at the high temperature, so it is mountable, but you might have some residual stress, and residual stress will be further coming from the cooling rate. Even though it is red hot all the way to here, well, if it is too hot, it will not hold this shape. You get what I mean? So it is too malleable. It will not maintain the shape. If it is too cold, then you will need a lot of force, then you leave a lot of stress concentration. You might end up with the crack in the cross section. So this is just the right temperature, not too hot, not too cold. And if it is too hot, then you mill it out, it might be, when it goes through the roller, it might be curved or bent. So it ends up with the problem. Okay, at the cooling bed, ASTM has the standard, right? Has the acceptance criteria for the product. So the out of straightness has to be checked. For example, ASTM require like L over 1000, if I'm not wrong, 1000 or 500. So out of straightness means it would be supposed to straight, but if it is out of straightness like this, the maximum out of straightness is L over 1000, I think. Yeah. That means for 1 meter, then you can be out of straightness for 3 millimeters. Huh? This requirement from ASTM will be later on adopted by the AISC and the way the code was made. So the initial out of straightness, which is controlled from the production, will be adopted and used as the initial out of straightness for the calculation for the second order effect in the next step. So everything ties up. If what we get from the steel production in our country cannot satisfy that original out of straightness from the US, and the US code was developed based on this, that might affect the capacity of our structure. So if original out of straightness you get from the factory, well, the dealer for steel, that would be the first one, okay, the business start from the first one who rolled the steel out into this shape, and that public company limited distributed to the dealers, many dealers. Big dealers sell to smaller dealers, maybe, and then to the local construction material shop, transportations many times. Well, you come to the job site, you might find that original out of straightness is it's not L over 1000, it is L over 250. If it is L over 250, then you might need to revisit when you design, because the code or the formula were made for L over 1000. So it is some sort of concern. And that's why when you design, you don't need to really show off. Show off means the demand is 99. The capacity you provide is 100. Okay? You try to make sure that you are so lean, so the DC ratio is really close to 1.0, and you say that, well, this is cool. I design this building, every member are close to the failure. It is just not there yet. Don't, okay? You don't need to show off. Maintain the DC ratio somewhere. For me? Well, first of all, I don't work as a designer. Okay. But when I design something for myself, for the testing facility, I make the DC below 0.3. Not even close to the yielding. For some structure, roof truss structure, when I design, I keep it below 0.6, 0.5. You never know. Member doesn't fail, but once the member is so small, the weld bead is very short. And something like that is difficult to control. So you should have more exposure at the job site, and you will see how people do bad things at the job site. And then you come back to your design and if I say that the weld bead should be 20 centimeters, I will expect only 7. And you can sleep in the night, right? You can sleep. You will not just wake up sometime in the night and, is that welder complete the beads properly? Sometimes you specify 2 rounds, make sure that the throat is 1 centimeter. But then they went to just 1 round, and then you have just half of it. You never know. Okay. Worst of the worst, it is even worse than Murphy's Law. Okay. You just stick with Murphy's Law. Well, you can read through. Okay. But all the pessimist point of view will be there when you practice, and everything could happen. So don't push yourself close to the limit. I will love to see, 0.6, good number for me. 0.7, okay, yeah. 0.8, maybe need bigger cross section. I need a peace of mind. Okay, so this is some more pictures. You can see reheating furnace, red hot, roughing mill. Okay, get into some shape. Continue the roughing mill. Okay, finishing mill. Cooling bed. This is the picture of the person. Roller and straightener. Sometimes if it is not straight, then you need to straight it out to match the requirement. But this is so-called hot roll. For the cold roll, the process, you might not need to heat up, or you might need to heat up just a little bit, but not this red hot. Okay. So you will leave a lot of residual stress in the cross section if you do the cold rolling. It can be done for the tube. Generally, the thin tube is made by cold roll. The tube in the market, the cheap one, generally, okay, you don't see the expensive one. The cheap one, the tube, even, well, both the square or the circular cross section come from the sheet of metal. So the metal sheet, and then it comes through the roller, so it gets into the circular shape or rectangular shape cross section. This is the cheapest way to produce. You imagine how to leave that hole in there when you do the hot rolling. The roller can be on the side. The roller cannot be in the middle. What will be used to keep the roller in the middle? There's nothing, right? Not possible. So the production process tends to be by just keep deforming it until it is coming down into the closed cross section. That is for the two cross section. And then over here it is the seam. The thing is that you can use this cross section for structural members, but you cannot use it for pressure vessel. So in the petroleum business or chemicals or in a factory, sometimes people need to transport the material with pressure. If it is coming with pressure, you cannot use this cold roll cross section. You will have to use the, they call it seamless tube. So the production, I do not know. If you want to know, Google. I do not want to know, so I didn't Google for you, but it is the seamless grade. So the seamless grade cross section, you will not have the weak point like this, so it will not be failed at the seam. Okay. At the seam, not sure that they use the welding or they just melt the two edge together during the production, heats up and then squeeze them together. You can look for the detail like that. I just do not have time to get into every detail of the steel production. Okay, and this is the roller and the design of roller. If you want to use a lot of finite element analysis, this is one way. You go to the steel company and then you design the roller. You design the roller for the both hot roll and cold roll. Yeah. Hot roll is easier, cold roll that is tricky, because you need to bend, you need to deform, and then you need to exceed the inelastic limit. So a lot in the industrial, like automotive industry or furniture industry, in the car, you think that it is a solid piece of steel? No. You should go to the scrap yard that collects a lot of crash, okay, steel chassis of the car. Every single piece in the body, in the chassis of the car these days, made of very thin metal. I think 1 point something, maximum is 2 millimeters in thickness. You feel like your car is is very you anticipate that it could be like a very solid cross section. No, they use the technique like this. They make the rib, they make the rib like this, gonna enhance the I value. You have the inertia, moment of inertia, and then you could have the lightweight slab, lightweight panel, and the strength is there. Because for the car industry, you need to make the engine smaller and smaller. As the engine gets smaller, if your chassis is heavy, you cannot accelerate the car. So every single piece gets thinner, 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 and thinner. Many pieces these days are replaced by plastic. Even for Mercedes, the back door, the whole piece is plastic. So, and furniture. Yeah, you look into the furniture. Good furniture. So many pieces are made of very thin steel, 1 millimeters maximum, maybe even less than 1 millimeters. But then it will go through the series of rollers. So the series of rollers, you need to design the shape and the size of the roller such that when it goes through the roller, you get the real 90 degree. For example, if you need this shape 90 degree, it goes through the roller, you get real 90 degree. How is it difficult? If you use your hand and bend the steel to 90 degrees and then you release, then elastic elastic unloading come in, and then boom, you get less than 90, right? So there's a lot of finite element activities in the design of the roller for the production. But okay, it's going to be repeating. Your life will be involving just the roller shape, get the good shape, and then go through the FEM simulations, and then I get this shape exactly what I want in the tolerance level that is acceptable. Because one set of roller is very expensive, so finite element can come in and pay off the price of the roller. Another thing is like the mold for the plastic injection, that is very expensive as well. So some of things like this for mass production seems to be very expensive, and that's the room for making money from finite element analysis. If you do the finite element analysis in the house, no, the homeowner say that I don't need it that much. Just put more material in. Don't care. The pie is not expensive. Concrete is not expensive. Finite element is more expensive than my beam. So forget about it. I don't care. So only researcher do the serious finite element analysis, not just the structural analysis. But in the okay, I think, yeah, we can wrap up over here. We are about to run out of time. Next class, we will continue at the mechanical property of steel. So that's going to be a lot of fun. You will know your steel from the inside out. You will explore through every organ inside steel, and that will be the fundamental